works, one of our strengths is we actually keep up in place. We have them across our services, our neighbourhood services, repairs, allocations and homelessness, etc. There is continually improved understanding of the data amongst staff, both from kind of service manager level down. We are discussing our team meetings and one-to-one. There are robust processes in place for managing performance and budgets, and again that's something that we're improving on all the time. And we very much do have a culture of performance management in our service. There's been a recent review of our policies and procedures, and they are obviously available in a global folder for everyone to access, still going through the final consultation phases. Weaknesses, slightly more than our strengths, which is a little bit of a negative, but I think we all recognise that sometimes we're not quite so good to pat ourselves on the back, but we're very good at looking at the more negative approach. The performance management frameworks we have at the moment are very much service approach, not locality focused. We're still collecting historical performance indicators. Stephen gave a good example, the debt and less than £250. We record too much. There's still an awful lot of manual recording, particularly within the locality teams, using SharePoint, etc. We don't do an awful lot in terms of value for money and comparison against the actual activities that we undertake. The time taken to complete PMS and for us, from the kind of team leader, service manager, coordinator level, we do quite a lot of analysis sometimes of the data and prepare for scrutiny meetings and things like that. Some targets quite often are simply not achievable. It's about being realistic in the approach. There are a lot of conflicting priorities between our service priorities and everything else that we have to undertake in day-to-day business. We don't always understand the impact of how we prioritise in one area could possibly have on the rest of the service delivery. Again, talking about value for money, what is the actual cost of high performance? And Stephen gave a good example. We're talking about, you know, kind of repairs and kind of measures of repairs within 3 hours. What's the performance on that? What's the cost in terms of value for money and cost across other parts of the service? PMS doesn't always actually reflect real workloads, as in the number of calls that come into our locality teams, the travel that our members of staff have to make across our service areas. And we're very good at focusing on the outputs rather than the outcomes. So some opportunities. Try to read that. I told you your mind was crap.
That sounded a bit like a threat.
How do we articulate between management information and performance information? So what we're seeing is there's sometimes quite a difference between the information that we actually need for kind of business, day-to-day business, service delivery and things like that, and actual targeted performance information and how we use the two can be different. We have to capture what matters, so it's about looking at all the information in our PMS, saying what can we use that for, do we need it, you know, where does that actually report back to the Scottish Housing Regulators, you know, chart how to use these things. It's having the right information that can then inform the correct decisions. We need to involve the frontline staff in any target setting that we do. Some of it we don't have a choice in it. You know, if it's key performance indicators, if it's chart or stuff, things like that. But if it's things to do with our day-to-day business, if it's about our own policies and procedures, we should be involved in the frontline staff. We should be making decisions that are made up there and then just cascaded down. We need to have meaningful targets that can be flexible. And what we were talking about there was, instead of having, for instance, one target for a task within the locality teams as a whole, it's actually recognising that each locality is very different in its own right, and that what might be a pressure on one locality team might not be so much in another, and it might not be a community target for that community but in another area of economic use. It's something that's very familiar. It's about educating our staff on finance and the links that has with performance and that how they do what they do on a daily basis, and affect budgets and what we have access to in the future. It's targeting the right information to the right people and focus on putting resources in the right place. So, you know, if our performance management shows that we're lacking in resources in an area, there's then maybe justification to get additional staff, and if we speak nice, we'll see them. How we prioritise and look at performance can also inform on risks to the services. A locality approach to PMF needs to be specified. I talked about that earlier. Look at how we actually consider our targets instead of being very specific and writing 92.6% for that target. Can we maybe just say that actually anything better than 90% is good and anything more than that's bad? We could capture info that, this is touched on earlier in terms of different systems, different services, and this one touched on the information that the community safety team gather about neighbour complaints. So we gather information, we upload it on SharePoint, put notes on Northgate, blah, 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 and you guys also do something very similar on Twitter. So, you know, there's an awful lot of duplicate recording and duplication in that work there. And we also said that there's an opportunity to do a little bit more kind of in-depth focusing on two localities that have gypsy traveller communities within them. And actually, there's not a huge amount in terms of performance management in relation to these gypsy traveller communities. So that's one outcome within the charter that I think we've all discussed on a number of occasions and can't actually pay for it. So it's an opportunity to do posts like that. And lastly, just kind of sort of threats, we didn't kind of have too many of these, and I don't know if that's good or bad. But management, and we're talking at kind of very senior level, we tend to look at the actual kind of detail and the model behind the performance. And one of the things that we're talking kind of as a sort of an example of that is, you know, you may have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cases that go very, very well, but the focus on the two that have gone very badly. And it's about kind of sort of how we kind of sort of correlate that and then part of, I'm closing the words, sorry. Potential threat is what the business priorities are compared to what the customer wants. We need a very, very clear idea about what our communities actually want from us, as locality teams. Some of that we can get from tenant satisfaction surveys. Some of the stuff we have no choice, we have to report on it regularly, it's the rest of it, but really not a lot of what we should do. It should be tied in with what the customers are dealing with on a daily basis actually want from us. And another threat really was the expectations of our elected members and the MSPs, because they're not managing the customer expectations when the customer speaks to them. So it makes it very, very difficult when complaints are then referred on to us in terms of how we manage our performance. That's me. Thank you very much.